It is obvious that the philosophical and traditionalized structure, that stems back to King Nimrod, has influenced society through its ruling powers that be, which has forced, shaped our understanding and perception surrounding the world we live in. Yet, of all the social institutions we are born into, directed by, and conditioned upon, there seems to be only one system that has been taken for granted, and misunderstood to unimaginable proportions, is that of money. Taken to religious levels and beyond, the established monetary institutions exists as one of the most unquestioned forms of faith there is on the planet, from how money is created, to the policies by which it is governed, and how it truly affects society as we know it. In a world where 1% of the population owns 40% of the planet's wealth, where tens of thousands of children die every single day from poverty and preventable diseases, and 50% of the world's population lives on less than $2 a day, one thing is certain: something is dreadfully wrong. Regardless of whether we are aware of the seriousness or not, the lifeblood of all of our established institutions, and thus society itself, revolves around money. Sir William Pitt, House of Lords, had this to say in 1770: "There is something behind the throne greater than the king himself." Benjamin Disraeli, English statesman, 1844: "The world is governed by very different personages from what is imagined by those who are not behind the scenes." Franklin D. Roosevelt, U.S. President, 1933: "The real truth of the matter is that a financial element in the large centers has owned the government since the days of Andrew Jackson." The American Revolution began as the American colonies who sought to separate themselves from England and its oppressive monarchy. Though there are many reasons for the revolution, what particularly stands out, as the primary cause, is that King George III of England outlawed the interest-free independent currency the colonies were producing and using for themselves. In turn, this forced them to borrow money from the Central Bank of England with interest, of course, which immediately put the colonies into debt. As Benjamin Franklin later wrote, the refusal of King George to allow the colonies to operate an honest money system, which freed the ordinary man from the clutches of the money manipulators, was probably the primary cause of the revolution. In 1783, America won its independence from England. However, the battle against the central bank concept, and the corruption associated with it, had only just begun. So what is a central bank? A central bank is an institution that produces the currency of an entire nation. Based on historical precedent, there are specific powers that are inherent in the central banking practice: the control of interest rates, and the control of the money supply, or inflation. The central bank does not simply supply a government's economy with money, it loans it to them with interest. Then, through the use of increasing and decreasing the supply of money, the central bank regulates the value of the currency being issued. It is critical to understand that the entire structure of this system can only produce one thing in the long run: debt. It doesn't take a lot of ingenuity, at this point, to figure out their scam. For every single dollar produced by the central bank loaned at interest, means every single dollar produced is actually the dollar plus a certain percentage of debt attached to it based on that dollar. Since the central bank has the monopoly for the production of the currency and lends each dollar out with an immediate debt attached to it, where does the money come from to reduce the debt? It can only come from the same source, the central bank. It is for this reason that the central bank has to perpetually increase its money supply, to temporarily cover the outstanding debt created, which only results in new money being loaned out at interest, creating additional debt. The end result of this system without fail is slavery, for it is impossible for the government, and thus the public, to ever come out of the self-generating debt. The founding fathers of our countries were well aware of this. Thomas Jefferson had this to say, 1743-1826, "I believe that banking institutions are more dangerous than standing armies. If the American people ever allow private banks to control the issue of currency, the banks and corporations that will grow up around them will deprive the people of their property until their children wake up homeless on the continent their fathers conquered." Sir Josiah Stamp said, 1880-19, 41, if you want to remain slaves of the bankers and pay for the costs of your own slavery, let them continue to create money and control the nation's credit. By the early 20th century, the United States had already implemented and removed a few central banking systems, which were swindled into place by the ruthless banking interests. At this time, the dominating families of banking and business were J.D. Rockefeller, J.P. Morgan, Paul Warburg, and Baron Rothschild. In the early 1900s, they sought to push, once again, legislation to create another central bank. However, they knew the government and public were wary of such an institution being created. These corrupt men needed to create an incident to affect the public opinion, so J.P. Morgan, who was publicly considered a financial authority and luminary at the time, exploited his influence by publishing rumors about a prominent bank in New York wasn't solvent or bankrupt. Morgan knew this would cause mass hysteria, which would affect the other banks as well. The public, in fear of losing their deposits, immediately began mass withdrawals. Consequently, the banks were forced to call in their loans, causing their recipients to sell their property, and thus a spiral of bankruptcies, repossessions, and turmoil materialized. Putting the pieces together a few years later, Frederick Allen of Life magazine wrote, "The Morgan interests took advantage, to participate the panic of 1907, guiding it shrewdly as it progressed. Unaware of the fraud, the panic of 1907 led to the congressional investigation headed by Senator Nelson Aldrich, who had intimate ties to the banking cartels and later became part of the Rockefeller family through marriage. The commission led by Aldrich recommended a central bank should be implemented, so a panic like 1907 could never happen again. This was exactly what the international bankers needed to initiate their contrived plan. In 1910, a secret meeting was held at the J.P. Morgan's estate on Jackal Island off the coast of Georgia. It was there that the central banking bill, called the Federal Reserve Act, was written. This legislation was written by bankers, not lawmakers. This meeting was so secretive, and concealed from government and public knowledge, that 10 or so figures who attended, disguised their identities when en route to the island. After this bill was constructed, it was then handed over to their political front man, Senator Nelson Aldrich, to push through Congress. In 1913, with heavy political sponsorship by the bankers, Woodrow Wilson became president, having already agreed to sign the Federal Reserve Act in exchange for campaign support. As a result, 2 days before Christmas, when most of Congress was at home with their families, the Federal Reserve Act was voted in and Wilson in turn made it law. Interestingly, the federal government of Canada also unjustly gave up this power to create money to the central bank around the same time. Woodrow Wilson wrote, "Our great industrial nation is controlled by its system of credit. Our system of credit is privately concentrated. The growth of the nation, therefore, and all our activities are in the hands of a few men, who necessarily, by very reason of their own limitations, destroy genuine economic freedom. We have become one of the worst ruled, one of the most completely controlled and dominated governments in the civilized world, no government by free opinion, no longer a government by conviction and the vote of the majority, but a government by the opinion and the duress of small groups of dominant men." Congressman Lewis McFadden also expressed the truth after the passage of the bill. He said, "A world banking system was being set up here, a super state controlled by international bankers, acting together to enslave the world for their own pleasure. The Federal Reserve has usurped the government. The public was told that the Federal Reserve system was an economic stabilizer, and inflation and economic crises were a thing of the past. As history has revealed, nothing was further from the truth. The fact is, the international bankers now had a streamlined machine to expand their personal ambitions. From 1914 to 1919, the Federal Reserve increased the money supply by nearly 100%, resulting in extensive loans to small banks and the public. Then, in 1920, the Federal Reserve called in mass percentages of the outstanding money supply, thus resulting in the supporting banks having to call in huge numbers of loans. And just like 1907, bankruptcy, and collapse occurred. Over 5,400 competitive banks outside of the Federal Reserve System collapsed, further consolidating the monopoly of the small group of international bankers. Privy to this crime, Congressman Lindbergh stepped up and said in 1921, and said, under the Federal Reserve Act, panics are scientifically created. The present panic is the first scientifically created one, worked out, as we figure, a mathematical equation. However, the panic of 1920 was just a warm-up. From 1921 to 1929, the Federal Reserve again increased the money supply, resulting once again in extensive loans to the public and banks. There was also a fairly new type of loan called the margin loan in the stock market. Simply put, the margin loan allowed an investor to put down only 10% of the stock's price, with the other 90% being loaned from the broker. In other words, a person could own $1,000 worth of stock, with only $100 down. This method was extremely popular in the roaring 1920s, as everyone seemed to be making money in the market. However, there was a catch to this loan. It could be called in at any time and had to be paid within 24 hours. This is termed as a margin call, and a typical result of a margin call was the selling of the stock purchased with the loan. So, a few months before October in 1929, J.D. Rockefeller, Bernard Baruch and other insiders quietly exited the market. On October 24, 1929, the New York financiers who furnished the margin loan started calling them in mass. This sparked an instantaneous massive sell-off in the market for everyone who had to cover the margin loans. It then triggered a mass collapsing for over 16,000 banks, enabling the conspiring international bankers to not only buy up rival banks at a discount, but to also buy up whole corporations at pennies on the dollar. It was the greatest robbery in American history. But it didn't stop there. Rather than expanding the money supply which were recovered from this economic collapse, the Federal Reserve actually contracted it, fueling one of the largest depressions in history. Once again, the outraged Congressman Louis McFadden, a longtime opponent of the banking cartels, began bringing impeachment proceedings against the Federal Reserve Board. Congressman Louis McFadden said, "It was a carefully contrived occurrence. International bankers sought to bring about a condition of despair, so that they might emerge the rulers of us all." Not surprisingly, and after two previous assassination attempts, McFadden was poisoned at a banquet before he could push for the impeachment. Having reduced society to that of a squalor, the Federal Reserve bankers decided that the gold standard should be removed. In order to do this, they needed to acquire the remaining gold in the system. So, under the pretense of helping to end the depression, came the 1933 gold seizure. Under the threat of imprisonment for 10 years, everyone in America was required to turn in all gold bullion to the Treasury, essentially robbing the public of what little wealth they had left. At the end of 1933, the gold standard was abolished. If you look at a $10 bill from before 1933, it says it is redeemable in gold. You look at the $10 bill today, it says it is legal tender, which means it is backed by absolutely nothing. It is worthless paper. The only thing that gives our money value is how much of it is in circulation. Therefore, the power to regulate the money supply is also the power to regulate its value, which is also the power to bring entire economies and societies to its knees. Mayor Amschel Rothschild, founder of Rothschild Banking Dynasty, stated, "Give me control of a nation's money supply, and I care not who makes its laws." It's important to clearly understand, the Federal Reserve is a private corporation. It makes its own policies, and is under virtually no regulation by the U.S. government. It is a private bank that loans all the currency at interest to the government, completely consistent with the fraudulent central banking model that the country sought to escape from when it declared independence in the American Revolutionary War. Today, roughly 48% of the average worker's income is taken from them through income tax. That means you work approximately 6 to 7 months out of the year to satisfy this tax obligation. And guess where that money goes? You guessed it, it goes to pay the interest on the currency being produced by the fraudulent banks, a system that does not have to exist at all. The money you make working 6 to 7 months out of the year goes almost literally into the pockets of the international bankers who own the banks. Consequently, understanding this institution of monetary policy is critical to knowing why our lives are the way they are. Unfortunately, economics is often viewed with confusion and boredom with endless streams of financial jargon, coupled with intimidating mathematics, quickly deters people from attempting at understanding it. However, the fact is, the complexity associated with the financial system is a mere mask designed to conceal one of the most socially paralyzing structures humanity has ever endured. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, 1749-1832, said, "None are more hopelessly enslaved than those who falsely believe they are free."
If you enjoyed this video, please don't forget to give us a thumbs up, and be sure to share.